Ah, such a beautiful day in Limgrave. A howdy, neighbor.
You suck!
That guy, always the jokester. I guess I should check my social media. Ah, what's this? A new Discord message? Surely whatever this is could not possibly ruin my perfect day. Elden Ring, but only using consumables. Can it be done? I don't know, but I'm gonna find out. First things first, thank you, Froshi, you beautiful man, for challenging me to this run. I am glad to know that you hate me. Since you did challenge me to this video, I decided to make my character look like you. But I only had this image to go off of, so I hope it's close. We had several choices for a starting gift, and in hindsight, the crackpot would have been way better, but we took the fanged imp ashes. I can already hear people saying, you're going to use the spirit calling bell? Yes, for the purposes of this run, anything that can go in the hotbar, with the exception of greases, count as a consumable. So things like the throwing dagger, poison stone clumps, and even the spirit calling bell count. Lastly, the rules are pretty simple. Kill all demigods and finish the game consumables only. With that, we're off. I'm already lost. Yeah, so I don't have a solid plan for this run. At the time of recording, Elden Ring had only been out for a couple weeks, meaning not even the wiki had been filled out. But I'm not one to back down from a challenge, so we head over to the Church of Ella and make a nice little discovery. Carley here sells an infinite amount of throwing daggers. So, if we have a way to get runes, we can at least buy our first weapon. Or weapons, in this case. For now, we buy the crafting kit, which is absolutely necessary in this run, and two throwing daggers. That won't get us very far. Oh well, let's test out our damage. Well, that doesn't bode well.
Oh, Mr. Tree Sentinel, no, I am not prepared for you. Please, no.
Okay, so my first thought was to collect the runes around the area, use them to buy throwing daggers, and use those to kill the animals to get thin beast bone to make bone darts. And sure, that is definitely something you could do, but I wanted to make progress sometime in the next decade, so we need to come up with a better plan. First things first, we meet Melina, get our trusty steed, and then take the spirit calling bell from Ronnie. Honestly, I'd like to try not to rely on spirits, but I have a feeling they're going to be necessary in the endgame. We head on over to Caelid and make one of our first important discoveries of the run. This version of Carley sells poison items, and three different varieties at that. I'm sure we'll be back, but for now, we head northeast until we find our old friend, the bowling ball. This will be our main source of income for a while, and no, it's not cheating because I didn't kill the bowling ball, gravity did. We farm until we have enough to purchase a couple hundred throwing daggers and a few of the poison bone darts. We also made sure to buy all the cookbooks and cracked pots we come across. After a little more bone dart farming, I say it's time we try Margit. Okay, so we come into the fight armed with 40 throwing daggers, bone darts, and poison bone darts, as well as 3 fire pots and jellyfish friend. We aren't doing terrible damage, but it's not amazing either, and we only have so many supplies. And while Margit doesn't dodge a whole lot, it is surprisingly easy to miss our daggers. Fortunately, I did know Margit could be poisoned, which is why I summoned Jelly to begin with. Unfortunately, I suck and Margit got the best of me. But I'm not one to be discouraged, I mean I'm literally doing a challenge run of a Souls game, so defeat is to be expected. So, I change up my strategy. This time, I poison Margit and summon the Fanged Imp for the bleed status, and after just a few attempts, Margit goes down. This is where I made a decision that runes from enemies could be used on whatever I want, but runes from farming could only be used for consumables unless something terrible happens. My next order of business is to get some armor. As much as I love staring at your back hair, Froshi, I would love it more if you had poise. We grab the knight's armor set from the roundtable hold, then we pick up Radagon's sword seal to boost our stats. We then grab the Crystallion's memento and give it to Rodrika and tell her her friends are dead. That way she'll help us later. Is that how other people make friends? I've been doing it wrong this whole time. Whatever, I'm feeling pretty confident about my ability to kill Godrick, so we give him a try. Our strategy remains largely unchanged. Poison the boss, then pelt him with daggers. It works for the most part, but the issue is the fight becomes extremely long, and my big wrinkled brain tells me the longer I'm in a fight, the more likely I am to die. So, when Godrick goes into phase 2, I decide to call out the imps for bleed. They don't last very long, neither do I because I get stuck in a corner. This fight is definitely doable without summons, but at this point, I simply didn't know that. With the game being so new, I just hadn't properly planned out this run. If I had the knowledge I did by the end of it, Godrick would have been toast, but oh well. We restock and it's time for attempt number 2. Yeah, that's a great start. Plan is the same, poison, daggers, imps for phase 2, we even brought firebombs for extra damage. Unfortunately, not everything goes according to plan. However, just one attempt later, the Lord of All That Is Golden falls to the Lord of Throwing Knives. Next on our conquest is Liurnia of the Lakes. Like always, we grab the key to Hogwarts, then raid the Academy because I never got my invitation. I was initially worried about the Red Wolf of Radagon because I knew he was so agile, but then I remembered. He ain't got no health. Combining the boss's low health with the ability to be poisoned, he goes down first try, but now we have our first real issue of a fight. Rennala, Queen of the Full Moon. So, what makes Rennala a tough fight? I mean, she isn't a particularly difficult boss moveset-wise. She can be poisoned, and in Phase 1, she doesn't even fight back. But that's the problem, isn't it? In Phase 1. Rennala, for all intents and purposes, is basically two bosses back-to-back. The issue is at this point, we simply don't have enough items to get through both phases. I tried using spirit summons to negate the cost of consumables, but they kind of don't know what to fight. In Phase 2 they do, because she's literally the only enemy for the most part, and admittedly the fight seemed to be going well, but I was almost out of ammo and she still had 75% of her health left. If I run out of consumables, I don't have a way to draw aggro off my summons, and if they die, it's just game over. So yeah, Rennala highlights the problem that multi-phase boss fights are not going to be easy, and if you've played the game, you know why that is terrifying. But I'll worry about that when I come to it. For now, I decide the best course of action is to just collect as many materials as I can and upgrade my spirits a bit. I tried a few different strategies out, usually trying to maximize the amount of damage from poison while minimizing the amount of consumables used. I was getting closer, but something was still missing. I even tried poisoning myself out of desperation, which in hindsight was pretty stupid, but it was an attempt. I switched to the Fanged Imp spirits at this point because I knew they could cause bleed if they would hit her. Victory just felt so close, yet so far. That was until I explored a little more, for you see, I came across a merchant in the Weeping Peninsula that sells a very, very useful item. He sells the Kukri. Why are these so useful? Well, one, it's another consumable for us to use in general, and it has an S scaling in dex, so we get even more damage, but that's not the best part. No, see that item effect? Throw at enemies to inflict damage and build up onset of blood loss. That's right, folks, these are blood daggers. So we do the only natural thing, we buy his entire stock. Going into Rennala, we have a full supply of throwing daggers, bone darts, kukri, poison bone darts, poison stone clumps, and firebombs, with a spirit summon to back us up. That bleed is juicy, and these kukri actually hit pretty hard, but their biggest drawback is that they're really slow. It takes a couple more attempts, but Rennala falls before the might of Froshi. There isn't much else to do, so we just ride for the Altus Plateau and make our way straight to the Draconic Tree Sentinel. He's a bit hard for this build. I learned if you sneak up behind him, you can get a few shots in before he can do anything. My plan for most bosses going forward is to just try and poison them early in the fight with the poison stone clumps and then live long enough to win. It takes a few tries, but we best the demon Lorax on the horse and make our way into Lindell, the royal capital. There's not much to say about the capital, I just parkour my way through it until we're at Godfrey, the first Elden Lord. Or, well, his ghost, at least. Fun fact, ghosts can't be poisoned. They also can't be bled. Why is that fun? It's not. I lied. I was a little worried about this fight because it basically meant we need to brute force our way through on numbers alone, and if you haven't noticed, we don't exactly hit that hard. I love this fight because it's one of those where you get into the groove, it feels so smooth, almost like a dance, but there's something off about Froshi just jumping around like a lunatic without a weapon. I don't know, it doesn't matter. After a couple tries, Godfrey falls before the Dagger Lord. After that bout, I decide it's high time we had a little R&R, so we make our way to Caelid for the Radahn Festival. There are no funnel cakes, there is no cotton candy, no rigged carnival games, 0 out of 10 festival, never coming again. Starscourge Radahn is not a fight I was particularly worried about. After all, he is a massive target, so he should be fairly easy to hit. That being said, large body usually means large health pool, but Radahn can be poisoned and bled pretty easily. I wanted to try to solo him because I didn't in the Rip and Tear run, and after a magnificent fight, he goes down second try. We head back to the capital to take on Morgott. Now, I was not particularly scared of Morgott. I mean, he could be poisoned and bled, so our strongest tools were still accessible, but he is the polar opposite of Radahn in terms of agility. Morgott loves jumping around the arena, so we need to make sure each of our shots count. This is where the speed of the kukri, or the lack thereof, starts to show itself. To throw one when the boss isn't doing anything usually results in them moving out of the way. And even as a follow-up, the windows to make sure one lands successfully are becoming tighter and tighter. The reason why that's an issue is because we need to keep the pressure up on them to cause bleed. Otherwise, they're just thick throwing daggers. We summon our marionette soldiers to try and draw aggro so we can reapply poison, but they, don't last long. It was pretty close, but in the end, Morgott goes down first try. I decide it's time to get the Volcano Manor questline out of the way. Not because I thought it would be easy, in fact it's the opposite. So we head over and pick up our first kill quest, Old Knight Istvan. So let me show you why this questline sucks. Yeah, NPCs dodge everything. It's not even that they have a lot of health, it's just that you can't hit them most of the time. It becomes a game of bait the attack and punish, which in fairness is how the bosses are going at this point, but the NPCs can basically animation cancel into a dodge. They can be bled, but kukri are just way too slow to reliably hit in these fights, so the best option is to poison and just chip away with regular daggers. The second target is Riley the Idol, who has an annoying rot crossbow and dagger combo, but the biggest issue is the cramped arena. But we can abuse this ledge right here to get a few easy hits off. The final target is Juno Hoslow, Knight of Blood, who is by far the hardest of the three. He has bleed whips and bloodhound step. It's not a good time, okay? I'm not really into being whipped, so we keep our distance and basically just poison him and run around this rock. It gets down to the wire with us being one hit from death, but he too falls to the Dagger Lord. With the assassination quest complete, I'm actually going to wait a little bit before having an audience with the Lord of Volcano Manor, and instead, we make our way to the mountaintops of the Giants, where we face the Fire Giant. Oh baby, that's a lot of damage. So the Fire Giant is what you would call a damage sponge. The intended way to fight him is to cut through his little rope hair braid things covering his weak points and hit those. While we can break them, we still do pebbles for damage. As such, my plan remains the same. Poison him and run away. The problem? It takes forever. Where Rennala showed us the issue with multi-phase fights, Fire Giant shows us an issue with bosses that have a lot of health. Sure hope there aren't any bosses that have both those problems. On my best attempt, I got him halfway through phase 2 before he dropped me. At this point, I thought it might be doable right now, but it would require playing perfectly, not missing a single thrown item, and making sure to stay on top of poison and bleed buildup. Luckily, it was around now that I actually checked online for consumables that I'm missing, and I found one that would be a massive help. The Swarm Pot. So, the Swarm Pot is a jar consumable that causes bleed, effectively giving us another way to inflict a percent damage. Perfect for something with so much health. The cookbook for the Swarm Pot is in Mogwin's palace, which is actually accessible without needing to kill the Fire Giant. All we have to do is use the secret rolled medallion and access the consecrated snowfield. To do that, we head to Castle Soul and take on Commander Niall. By himself, the commander isn't that tough. It's his two idiots that are the problem. I don't know why, but they all three seemed more aggressive than normal. Sure, the dual-wielding one always runs me down, but last time I did this fight, the shield and commander politely waited their turn. I'm not sure if that was just luck, or if something actually changed, but this is not going so hot. I gave this fight a fair few attempts before realizing that the aggression, coupled with it being a gank fight, makes it extremely difficult to surpass. Even if I summon my own spirits to level the playing field, they're pretty weak and only serve as a brief distraction. It was time to think of a new strategy. First, we head down and into the Eternal City to grab a new spirit, the Mimic Tear. But first, I must prove myself worthy. It's a battle of... well, not even wits or bronze. This is just a dumb fight to do this way. Fake Feroshi just kind of dives around everywhere avoiding my projectiles. He will occasionally throw some of his own, but he'd rather cheat and use his hands as weapons. Honestly, because his fists do so little damage, it's easier just to let him punch me while I'm hitting him in the face point blank. After this, fight, Fake Feroshi goes down. The Mimic Tear probably wouldn't be useful for the commander fight, but I'll need him later anyway. After that, we roam around the land picking up a few sacred tears when we just happen to end up at the Bellum Church. Do you know what's behind the Bellum Church? It's another merchant. A merchant that sells bewitching branches. Bewitching branches are a consumable that charms an enemy. Man, I sure hope this works. Okay, first try. Well, that's unfortunate. Maybe I wasn't close enough. Well, let's just try it again. Oh, it worked. Yes, fight my minion. Wow, he is doing a lot of damage. I kind of just thought the commander would kill him and that would be end of it, but he's putting in work. I guess I'll charm the other one. After all, no one can resist Feroshi's face. Okay, that one didn't last as long, but that's fine. Now that it's a one-on-one fight, it's much more manageable. We poison the boss, then just play it safe. Eventually, the commander goes down. We make our way through the consecrated snowfields, having wartime flashbacks to the Blizzard area in the Ivory King DLC from Dark Souls 2. Nothing really eventful happens here. We need to kill Sanguine Noble in order for the portal to activate, and that's... fun. We basically spend 10 minutes playing Ring Around the Rock until eventually he dies and we're off to Mogwin Palace. We grab the cookbook and decide we'd rather be a pancake than bird food, and with that, we head back to the Fire Giant. The plan was still the same. Poison him first, wait it out to maximize damage, bonus points for the Torrent iframe style. I wasn't honestly sure if I had enough resources to kill him even with the extra bleed item, so I wanted to make sure. Also, I wanted to wait until phase 2 because I thought he'd be easier to hit with the pots. Sure enough, I was right, and the jars rip him apart. After a few follow-up daggers, the Fire Giant falls before us. After we commit a cardinal sin, we're off to Faramazula, where a notoriously hard boss is located. Also Maliketh. The Godskin Duo is... not a fun fight. I've said it before, I'm sure I'll say it again, but they don't mesh together the way FromSoft wants them to. I thought maybe the Bewitching Branch could work and that it would be hilarious, but I guess they just weren't having it. On the next attempt, I summon Mimic, not because I think it'll do any damage, though two Feroshis would be unstoppable, but because I just thought it would be great to have one of the Godskins be distracted. Man, Mimic tier nerf went hard, didn't it? You might have noticed I'm fighting the Noble here, even though I actually prefer to fight the Apostle. Well, that's for two reasons. One, the Apostle will dodge out of the way of my items, even when I don't throw them at him, cough input reading, cough cough. But more importantly, the Noble's most deadly attack, Rollout, can be stopped by these pillars, which, assuming the Apostle isn't trying to murder me, lets me get in a few easy throws. It took a handful of attempts, but eventually the duo go down. Also, I had originally planned on using sleep pots for this fight. In fact, before starting the fight, I remember thinking, I should go get that cookbook. Then I just... forgot? Oh well, doesn't matter. Parkouring our way around Faramazula, we eventually make our way to the Beast Clergyman. He moves pretty fast, but thanks to my fists only run, I'm pretty comfortable with his moveset. In no time, we push him into phase 2, the cooler Beast Clergyman. Of course, Melikast still hits like a truck, and it's not long before we're pushed back into phase 0. This is the point where we have to start really treating bosses like puzzles instead of something we can just unga bunga our way through. All of the bosses from here on out are going to have large health pools, hit hard, and move fast, so we need to make sure we're paying careful attention to our resources while fighting. For example, I learned for Beast Clergyman, one poison application and two bleed procs is enough to push him into phase 2, so as soon as I saw the poison cloud, I switched to swarm pots until the flies did their job. I won't mention the strategy for every boss, but it's just important to know that you can't fling things at them and hope it'll work now. It took a while, but eventually Maliketh the Black Blade falls before Feroshi the Dagger Lord. Next up on the chopping block, Sir Gideon Ofnir, the All-Knowing. Normally, this boss isn't an issue. Sure, he has access to some really powerful spells, but a good counter to him is punch to the face no jutsu. The problem is, I can't do that. I'm not allowed to use that jutsu, so Ofnir actually kind of posed a problem. It's here I made a decision that I might as well go level up my spirits, as I had a feeling I'd need them, so around the world we go looking for little balls we can give to old ladies for flowers. Wait, no, maybe I should rephrase that. We even started a whole ass side quest for Princess Rani, long may she reign, so we could do this. We went all the way into Nokron, through the Lake of Rot, even into Miquella's Hallig Tree. While I'm here, I just want to see how the Malenia fight would feel. Ah, yes. I'm actually kind of impressed with how low we got our health on the first try. We'll be back, Malenia. Oh, we'll be back. We make one more stop to kill the ulcerated tree spirit to get the Cerulean Hidden Tear. This will let us use spirits we don't have enough FP for. After all that, we make our way back to Gideon. So how does it go? Yeah, not great. But hey, our spirit's doing good damage, so that's something. Obviously, that was my fault, and after a few more attempts, we stand victorious. Next on the chopping block, Godfrey the First Elden Lord. Except for real this time. So since this isn't a ghost version of Godfrey, he can be poisoned and bled. Great! What isn't so great is that he be schmoving. Godfrey isn't as mobile as some bosses, or rather he won't dodge as much as other bosses, but he can move really quickly when he does his zoom thing, meaning slower consumables need to be carefully timed. but with enough patience, we push him into phase 2, Horalu Warrior. And promptly get fucking curb stomped. God, I love this fight. I gave it a few more tries, but we were rapidly running out of materials, so I guess it's time to farm. The main consumable that I'm needing to keep stocked is the swarm pots, and those take two ingredients, mushrooms and blood-tainted excrement. What you're seeing now are the two farms I did to collect these materials. They aren't particularly difficult, but as far as I could tell, these two things could not be bought, so I had to pick them up by hand. Sorry, Froshi, hope you have a swimming pool filled with rubbing alcohol. At the end of the farming session, you think I just went on a drug-induced bender to Taco Bell, because we have over 600 mushrooms and blood-tainted poos. Hashtag not sponsored. But totally would be. DM me sometime, Taco Bell, I love you. I also decided to go get another cookbook that'll be useful, the Glintstone Craftsman Cookbook 6, which will allow us to make frost pots. It's at this point I decided to look up if there was anything that could help us. And surprisingly, there was. Emphasis on was. It turns out there is actually a helmet and talisman that will increase jar damage, the jar and companion jar, respectively. However, those are both behind Alexander's questline. Can you guess which NPC I ignored? Trick question, I ignored all of them, but Alexander is the second best answer. Without those tools, we're going to need to be even more clever than normal, so I decided it was time to grab the Bloodhound Step Ash of War from the Knight's Cavalry. Originally, I had planned just to let Gravity do the job for me, because he's a little bit hard to hit with his horse, but we turned him into an undead pincushion, so it doesn't really matter. Lastly, we buy a dagger, because unfortunately, I cannot put Bloodhound Step on my fists, and with that, we head back to Chadfrey. The strategy is basically the same as before, except I added in rot pots. Scarlet Rot really takes chunks off his health. I actually ended up running out of patience for this fight, so I use Latel the Headless, and after a few tries, Horalu falls before the might of the Dagger Lord. Only 5 more fights, victory is close at hand. We make a quick pit stop at the Second Church of America to fight not Darth Maul, because she drops the purifying crystal tier. Then we make our way back to Taco Bell and head for Mogh, Lord of Blood. Did you know that the blood god in the blood area who uses blood to fight is weak to blood? Because he is, by a lot. The plan is the same. Poison, bleed, murder. Using the purifying crystal tier lets us not take damage from his arena-wide bleed AoE. Wish I would have known that a long time ago. Oh well, after a few dozen daggers, Mogh goes down, Thor left. I decide it's finally time to have an audience with the Lord of Volcano Manor, Rykard. See, this boss has both issues I mentioned previously. It's a 2-stage fight, and both stages have a large health pool. You're intended to use the Serpent Hunter Spear, but that's not a consumable, so I can't. The God-Devouring Serpent can be poisoned, bled, frostbitten, and rotted, so we have access to all our tools, but the sheer amount of health he has means we have to rely on pretty much only those things. Regular damage is going to be worthless. So, what are we gonna do? Well, I can't use the Serpent Hunter. But my mimic can, and that counts as a consumable. It takes a few tries, but the combination of mimic using the spear and all of our status effects, Rykard, the Lord of Blasphemy, can join us on our dagger-filled quest. Only 3 remain. I wish this is where the story ends. I wish this is where I could tell you that Malenia, Radagon, and the Elden Beast went down in a few tries. But that's not what happened. Far from it. Before we move on, I just want to explain why these fights are so difficult, starting with Malenia, Blade of Miquella. I won't bother explaining to you why she's so difficult as a boss, because you all already know. Lifesteal, water flow, blah blah blah. Instead, I'll explain why she's difficult in this run. Here's a photo of her resistances. I know the numbers are a bit arbitrary, but 252 is basically normal. Malenia has an enormous resistance to Scarlet Rot. That makes sense, she is the goddess of rot after all, but she also has an equally large resistance to regular poison, meaning that our normal strategy of trying to whittle her down slowly isn't going to work. Fortunately for us, she is extremely weak to frost and bleed. Unfortunately, however, when enemies in this game are afflicted with a status effect, they actually gain a resistance to it, meaning subsequent applications become harder and harder. This is most easily noticed with frost pots on her. As the first time, it only takes 1 pot, same with the second time, but then it takes 2 pots to proc Frostbite, then 3 pots for the fourth application. To make it even worse, she will jump out of the way of our projectiles. That's right, if she's not in the middle of an animation, she will dodge our already pathetically weak attack. So basically, in order to inflict any damage at all, we need her to be doing something, or put in a different way, we need her to be trying to hit us, we dodge, then immediately follow up with something. I know that sounds like the normal gameplay loot for fighting, and it is, but remember, we only have so many chances to attack. If we miss too many times, we just lose by default. Phase 1, she's pretty passive, only attacking when you get near her. This lets us control the fight fairly easily, baiting attacks and counterattacking when we're able to do so. Phase 2, on the other hand, she gets way more aggressive, constantly rushing us down. It makes the fight way harder as she's now in control and we are actively running away from her most of the time, just trying to bait a punishable attack, of which there are few. Not to mention that attempts that do make it to phase 2 usually take longer than 15 minutes, meaning this whole fight is both a sprint to kill her before she can outheal our damage, and an endurance race to make sure we're patient enough to live. Okay, so what about Radagon in the Elden Beast fight? Looking at Radagon first, he's actually not that bad. Sure, he's immune to bleed, but is weak to frost, and not terribly resistant to rot or poison. His attacks are all pretty easy to dodge with a little bit of practice, and he doesn't have a lot of health. He does have this extremely annoying ability to catch your projectiles, basically nullifying their damage and throwing them back at you. That sucks, but it just means, like Malenia, we have to wait for opportunities to attack. So, what's the problem? He doesn't really seem that hard by himself. Well, that's the problem, isn't it? He isn't by himself, is he? No. Radagon is coupled with the Elden Beast for a duo boss fight. Okay, so what's the big deal with the Elden Beast? Well, not only does he have a massive health pool, but he's immune to literally everything. He cannot be bled, he cannot be poisoned, he cannot be rotted, and he can't be frostbitten. This means we need to do 22,127 points of raw damage after we've already killed Radagon. Fortunately, the Elden Beast isn't a particularly hard boss. I mean, he hits like a truck, but most of his attacks are slow and incredibly telegraphed. However, I knew for both of these fights that I wasn't ready, and it was here that I truly became a foul tarnished, spurned not by the graces of gold, nor fueled by the flames of ambition, but instead driven only by an intense hatred. So we set out to become stronger. The next roadblock was how to grind runes. Sure, I could easily use throwing daggers to kill some enemies, but that's painfully slow, and I'd like to put this video out sometime before I'm, you know, dead. I thought about breaking my rule of consumables only and farming this big chicken, but in the end, I happened upon this little glitch right here. Yep, that's about 130,000 runes for falling through the sky. If I had to guess why this is happening, I'm assuming it's because when I got too far away from the currently loaded area, the ground despawned, but the enemies didn't, causing them to fall to their deaths. This kind of chunk loading and unloading is pretty common in huge open world games as it helps save on memory. Now normally when you fall more than 12 seconds, the game just automatically kills you, but for some reason attacking on the back of Torrent resets the timer. I'm sure one or all of these things will be patched out eventually, but for now I am so thankful it exists. So we do this run over, and over, and over again until we grind to the unholy level of 225. For reference, my main character, that I also 100%ed the game on, only ever reached level 194. My character, that is at the end of New Game Plus, is not as high level as this New Game character. If there was ever a point that I was close to going hollow, this was it. Well, why not use the mimic tier, I hear you asking? Because it doesn't work. At least not for Malenia. She eats spirits for breakfast, and it would have thrown off my timing when it came to trying to frost or bleed her anyway. For Radagon and Elden Beast, however, I did use it. I really wanted to do these fights alone, but after literal weeks of on and off attempts, I decided to give in and just hand mimic tier a plus 25 frost greatsword and let him go to town. Even doing that, the fight wasn't easy. If I summoned Mimic too early, Radagon would nearly kill him, setting Elden Beast up for a 1 or 2 shot on it. I tried using Shabiri's Woe to keep aggro, but that didn't seem to help at all. In the end, the winning strategy was to basically solo Radagon, then summon Mimic for the Elden Beast. After many, many attempts, I got one where Mimic lived a decent ways into the Elden Beast fight, allowing me to finish him off. And it is here that Feroshi takes the title of Elden Dagger Lord. But it's not over, is it? No. There's one more fight, and I am determined to do it alone. I'm not lying when I say this fight alone took me weeks of practice. Everything about it has to be played perfectly. The damage from these consumables are so minimal, even at such a stupid high level, that one mistake could mean the end of the run. The strategy was to poison her first, then hit her with as much damage as we could, poison her again, continue. I needed to save my faster projectiles for phase 2, as well as my frost pots, so for phase 1 I stuck to fire pots, gravity stone chunks, and the gravity fan item. I would recommend swarm pots over fire pots for the bleed, but I already had fire pots crafted, so that's what I ended up using. When phase 2 started, I tried using the Kukri to proc bleed, but they're just too slow, so I knew I needed to get all 4 procs of frostbite. Then, just use my fast projectiles to deal damage while also being able to quickly get out of the way. Her big fire blossom attack is ideal as she sits still for a long time, but unfortunately for me, she didn't use it frequently until the very end. This ended up being a 25 minute endurance fight, but after days of heartbreak, she finally dies. I'll link the full fight in the description and in the card if you're interested, but with this, Feroshi has officially ascended as Elden Dagger Lord. Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching. This run, I don't even know. I mean, up until Malenia, it was a fun, nice little challenge, but she is just a stupid high wall that I can't recommend anyone else ever do this. If you're bound and determined to do it, please make sure to do Alexander's questline. Get the Jar Helmet and Companion Jar Talisman. Don't be stupid like me. Is it possible to do this at a lower rune level? Probably. Will I be the one to find out what rune level? Nope. Big shout out to Feroshi, the man who came into my stream and asked me to do this run. Wonderful guy, great streamer. I'll leave his and my Twitch links in the description below. I do stream all my challenge runs every week, so if you want to challenge me to do something, by all means, stop by. If you enjoyed the video and made it this far, please consider giving a like and subscribing. It really helps me out and lets me know you guys are enjoying the content. But until next time, don't you dare go hollow.